And once again, we return to Final Fantasy IV. Part 1 had me cover the overworld, Part 2 saw me in the underworld, and for Part 3 we're checking out the moon. From this giant crystal building we see here, I go south to find a cave hidden away. Like the Sylph Cave, I never discovered the Hummingway abode until playing the GBA version. These all share the same sprite as Namingway. The majority of them simply hum at you when you talk to them, which plays a little jingle. The red one in the back left says that one of them once built a ship and travelled to Earth and was good at naming things. Back then, I never expected Namingway of all characters to get a backstory. It seems he was the only one, as the one in the back right corner is confused about the concept of changing names. One of the wandering ones actually is Namingway, and another has a shop that sells elixirs, but you have to find them in the crowd. That's all for this place. Northwest of that building is a cave, and I land the Lunar Whale on the mountain next to some stairs that lead to it. The cave entrance leads to the West Lunar Tunnel. This is just one screen. I go northeast to a chest, then west and north. Then it's east past the exit, two more chests, and backtrack to the exit. The first chest is a monster in a box. Both new enemies, Prokaryote and Eukaryote. The moon only has a few strange enemies, with this type being one. Killing them gets me a golden apple, which increases a character's maximum HP by 100 instead of the 50 from silver apples. I give it to Rydia since she has the lowest maximum HP. The moon also has my next bomb variant, the Dark Grenade. Cecil reaches level 46 from this fight. The other two chests contain a Lunar Curtain and Stardust. Then my next new enemy is an Abyss Worm. We haven't seen this enemy type in a while. They're a pain because they use Blood Feast, which is normally exclusive to bats, so it's a bat with thousands of HP. From the fight after this one, Edge reaches level 42 and Rydia reaches level 44. Taking the exit puts me back outside. Thanks to the moon's layout, I can only travel east and then south to another cave. This is the East Lunar Tunnel. This one's less interesting, just west and south of the exit. I get through with just a single fight. All I can do here is go west and enter the Crystal Palace. From the entrance, to the left is a tile that restores HP and removes status effects. Then to the right is one that restores MP. But walking straight ahead from the entrance has the party welcomed. In the chair in front of them, a sentient beard appears. This is Fusoya, whose duty is to protect the slumber of the Lunarians. Centuries ago, there was a fifth planet in the solar system between Mars and Jupiter, but it was about to be destroyed and the Lunarians escaped on a ship to Earth. But the species on Earth were still evolving, so the Lunarians built the moon so they could sleep. But one of them didn't want to sleep and wait, he wanted to wipe out life on Earth so they could move in right then. Fusoya managed to seal him away, but even sealed he could still project his will over to Earth and corrupt people, using them to gather the crystals. It's clear this person is the one behind Golbez and is the mysterious evil that Asura warned Rydia of. This Lunarian is Zemus, and he intends to use the crystal to power the interdimensional elevator within the Giant of Babil and use said giant to destroy everything on Earth. The remaining Lunarians are asleep until Earth civilization was advanced enough for the Lunarians to live alongside them. As for the Lunar Whale, it was built by Fusoya's brother, Cluia. He was fascinated by Earth and used the whale to get there, creating the Devil's Road and introducing airship technology to its people. And while he was there, he got married and had children, one of them being Cecil. This makes Cecil realise that the voice he heard on Mount Ordeals was Cluia's soul. Fusoya even says that Cecil looks like Cluia did when he was his age. Does that mean Cecil's hair is going to turn blue in his old age? Fusoya says they must hurry to the Tower of Babel to prevent the giant's transportation there. When Edge asks how they get around the barrier, Fusoya says he should be able to enter and joins the party. So we got Cecil's beard space uncle. To show how much more experienced he is than everyone else, he starts at level 50. The gap between him and my party should be bigger, but I gained all those extra levels filling the bestiary. He's basically a better version of Teller. He has low stats but knows every spell in the game. He has more MP than Teller and can actually cast Meteor, but unless you spend hours farming Soma drops, his MP is fixed at 190 until he reaches level 70. Also his name. Until the DS version, his name was spelled with alternating capital letters. So capital F, U, capital S, O, capital Y, A, and Cluia also had the Y capitalized. SNES, PS1 and GBA had this, but DS and on removed it. I know there are people who preferred the way it used to be to make it sound more alien, but I'm perfectly fine with this change. It made it harder to tell how his name was pronounced. Was it Fusoya? Fusoya? Or do you pronounce each capital letter like a new word? Fusoya? Or do you go the Sir Ron Lionheart route and say each letter? F-U-S-O-Y-A? One thing I've learned from Final Fantasy is that you need an easy way to tell how a character's name is pronounced, or people will get it wrong in a million ways. If FF10 didn't include the option to rename Tidus and just said his name in-game, the Tidus pronunciation would never exist. Does anyone else remember the pre-advent children days of Tifa and Yuffie? Even names that actually exist in our real world like Cecil and Zidane people get wrong all the time. I've seen people go with Zidane once. How is that even possible? Anyway, there's another room in the back containing the moon's crystals. They work with the 8 crystals on Earth to maintain the moon's balance. They also keep Zemus locked away in its core. Step 1 is to return to the Lunar Whale. On the way, I get two new enemies, Lunar Virus and Black Flan. Fusoya also has the ability Regen, which heals small amounts of MP over time. It's not very useful, and I never use it. Also, since I forgot to check my bestiary at the end of last episode to see where I was, I check it now. 65% of all enemies killed. I get back to the Lunar Whale, and while Fusoya said we have to hurry or all life on Earth will be destroyed, I think I can squeeze in a little side quest. East of the Crystal Palace is another cave in a circle of mountains. I have to land on the mountain and go down the stairs to get to it. This is the Lair of the Father. I start by going south to the first chest, then back north a little and east. I keep going east for a hidden passage to the second chest. I backtrack through the passage and go east and south to the stairs down to B2. I get a new enemy type here, the Armored Fiend. We're now at the point where regular enemies can have 14,000 HP. Even bosses didn't have that much until I reached the underworld. Rosa reaches level 46 from that fight. My next fight are new variants of all enemies, Dark Sage and Moon Maiden. Dark Sages are going to be very important in a later episode. That's because if they drop an item, there's a 12% chance on top of that chance of an item drop that they'll drop a Soma drop. And what are the chances that the very first Dark Sage I kill drops one? That's insane! I give it to Cecil. The first chest contains Genji gloves, which I give to Cecil. Genji equipment tend to be some of, if not the best, in a Final Fantasy game. These ones are certainly good, but they're still better. Also, the amount of back attacks here are ridiculous. I got 3 in a row. Edge reaches level 43 from that third one. And from the next fight, Cecil reaches level 47. Riddy reaches level 45 and learns Fundiga. The second chest has Genji Shield, which also goes right on Cecil. Then it's down to floor B2. Here I go west, then north to the first chest, then east to the second chest, back west a little, and north to the stairs to B3. The first chest has Genji armor, Cecil gets it, and finally the second chest gets Cecil a full Genji set with Genji helm. On the way to the exit, there's a tile that automatically triggers a battle with a behemoth. These are so powerful right now that they get the boss theme. They have 23,000 HP and respond to all physical attacks with a strong physical attack of their own, and offensive non-summon magic with Maelstrom. This is the only location in the game to have tiles that trigger encounters. That was more of an FF1 thing. Casting Blink on everyone does the trick, since eventually it can never hit me. Once it's dead, I'm off to B3. This one's very simple. I go south, west, and north again to my target for this place. A few steps down the path is a second tile that triggers a behemoth fight. Killing it raises Edge to level 44. Going down the path, I get another palette swap of Golbez's Shadow Dragon, the Silver Dragon. Killing this gets Rosa to level 47 and Fusoya to level 51. Close to the end, I get a new enemy type, the Bone Dragon. As I reach the end of this path, I get one more behemoth fight. I may as well take the chance to point out my favourite sprite in the original FFR, Fusoya's Death Sprite. He just melts into a beard puddle, it's great. Killing this one gets Cecil to level 48. There's these two kids at the end whose purpose I don't get, and past them is the father of Eidolons, Bahamut. If you haven't defeated Leviathan yet, you can't face him. Bahamut has 45,001 HP and no weaknesses. He counts down from 5 on each of his turns, and once the countdown is over, he casts Mega Flare, which deals massive damage. The only way to deal with Mega Flare is to cast Reflect on the party, which will bounce Mega Flare back at him, as hinted at in the Eidolon Library last episode. I could have done this first, but grabbing Fusoya makes this easier, since I can't cast Reflect on the entire party at once, so having two casters makes it much safer. As for the others, Cecil and Edge attack while Rydia throws out her strongest magic. I don't quite have the time to reflect everyone in the first cycle though, and Cecil is taken out. At the end of his next cycle, everyone is set up and he takes himself out. Bahamut will now allow Rydia to summon him. Just about all the side quests pre-GBA were based around Rydia getting more summons. Bahamut is our first reliable way of dealing the full 9,999 damage, which it will do to just about every enemy. There is Fusoya's Meteor, but that 99 MP cost makes it too expensive to be very useful. Also, using it on armor constructs has them self-destruct on you if you don't kill them with it. On the way out, I get a gold dragon. I don't tend to remember all old names from previous localizations, but for some reason I always remembered Ginryu and Kingryu for the gold and silver dragons. As a 9 or 10 year old, I was wondering what those names even meant, not knowing they just left their names in Japanese because it was fewer letters and they couldn't fit the full English names in back then. It's also why the Archfiends had different names back then. Mylong, Keinatsu, Valvalis and Rubicant, or Rubicunt as our accents almost made it sound like. Rydia reaches level 46 and Edge reaches level 45. I get back to the Lunar Whale and head back to Earth. We land in Eblem where the ground starts shaking. This is the memorable part in the SNES version when they localised Rydia screaming as her just yelling the word, scream. It's too late, the Giant of Babil is here. But then we get a new cutscene of the Giant appearing. This isn't from the DS version, I noticed the Tower of Babel's design here not matching the DS one, so I looked at the cutscene and sure enough it's different. So it makes me wonder how many cutscenes I've labelled as belonging to the DS version were actually made for the PSP. I haven't played the DS version since early 2010. It seems like there's nothing to be done until Cecil notices something. The Giant of Babil comes under fire from the Red Wings and the Dwarven tanks, and everyone's showing up to the fight. Jot brought his 4-year-old daughter to a war zone, and Young and the Sills get a tank too. So remember last episode how I said as a kid I missed Young being alive until this scene? On the PS1 he says he can't rest knowing everyone else is still fighting. Since this was my first time seeing him after getting blown up, I thought he meant rest in peace and was coming back from the afterlife to help out the fight with a pair of angels backing him up. Meanwhile in the airships, Sid's recovered and taking the lead, even bringing his engineers along for the ride. And there's the Mycidian Elder with Porom and Palom. He managed to restore them from stone without setting off the wall trap again. The first thing he does after freeing the 5-year-olds from Eternity of Statues is even more child endangerment. Even Edward has recovered and has brought 4 of V-Pops with him. The other 4 couldn't be asked to show up. I make jokes, but this is a genuinely awesome scene, getting to see everyone else again at their best and teaming up at the worst moment. Except Teller, lazy prick couldn't be asked to come back from the dead and help. With the Giant confused from this attack, now is the chance to enter it. The party get on the Enterprise and have Sid aim for its mouth. Not even living beards from the moon get reverence from Sid, and he flies the party inside. We land inside the Giant's head. I'm not mapping this room out, it's just a short walk north. On this floor I fight a Searcher, the next level up from Security Eye. You can steal sirens from these too. Hitting this one has it call another new enemy, Clockwork Soldier. I go down to the next floor, which is just 3 steps south into the chest. This is much bigger. I go south and west to find the first chest, then south, west, north, west, south all the way, east and north to the second. I then go south across the bridge and east and north to the third chest, then it's all the way to the northeast corner for the fourth. I backtrack a little and go east and south to the fifth chest, then go north to the next floor. The first chest has a shuriken inside, second has a high potion, third has an ether, fourth has Yoichi arrows. I got this far before getting my first fight. It has 2 new enemies, Centaurian and Beam Cannon. It took until this version for me to realise that the end of the Beam Cannon is the laser in the middle of firing. I thought it was a drill head for years and I was just fighting a basic power tool. Rosa reaches level 48 from this fight. The next fight is against the Palace Up of the Armor Fiend, Armor Construct. Killing these gets Cecil up to level 49. He's catching up to dear old Uncle Fusoya. The final chest on this floor has a siren inside and it's down to the Giant's stomach. First I go north to the first chest, then east all the way and north to the second. Then backtrack a bit and slightly west of that I go north all the way and follow the path west to the next floor. First chest has a silver apple that goes to Rosa. Second has a Soma drop that goes to Cecil. That's all and I head into the Giant's inner passage. I go all the way south and all the way east, grabbing a chest on the way. Then north, west to a safe point and north to the next room. The chest is a monster in a box. We have another Security Eye variant, the Optic Blaster, except these don't summon monsters. They'll target a character and on their next turn use electromagnetism to inflict stop on them. All I get is an elixir. From my next fight, Edge reaches level 46. After saving, Fusoya reaches level 52. I hang around here trying for the last enemy I still need. I get one when a Searcher summons a new enemy type, the Clockwork Dragon. Ridia reaches level 47 and learns Quake from this fight. Right after, Rosa reaches level 49. Now I can move on to the Inner Stair. This is just a straight line north. But halfway through we get stopped. It's the Archfiends. Zemus gave them a second chance and revived them. Rubicante's realization of how powerful joining forces is before he died the first time have influenced them to try the same thing. But first he heals us up before the fight. The Elemental Archfiends have a combined 112,000 HP. Each one keeps their own weaknesses when we start with Scamiglione. He only gets to try some physical attacks and a single curse on Fusoya before I throw my Firegaze at him and take him out. Next is Rubicante, who's much easier because he doesn't use his cloak in this fight, so I don't have to worry about accidentally healing him. Inferno is also much weaker than it used to be. Just a few Blizzagers to take him down and move us on to Kanyatso. He's always in his rising water state, but it's just a choice of sprite, it doesn't mean anything. Just a few Thundergus and he goes down just as easily as in his first fight. Only Barbaricia remains, she's always in a tornado form, but like Kanyatso it doesn't mean anything. That holy weakness she has comes into play here, as Sissel's Excalibur does a nice 5,000 damage. At this point it's the end of the fight so I just start throwing out the Bahamuts and Meteors until she's finished. Cecil reaches level 50 from this. The Archfiends beg for one more chance from Zemus before they all die again, one by one. After healing I go through the exit at the north into the Giant's control core. We reach its CPU, which decides to attack the party itself. The boss is in 3 parts, the CPU, attack node and defense node. The CPU has 30,000 HP and both nodes have 3,000 HP each. The CPU starts by casting Reflect on itself, the attack node has the weak beam attack, and the defense node heals the CPU for a large amount. So I deal with the defense node first. But we don't want to kill the attack node yet. Killing both nodes and leaving the CPU alive will have it spam Globe 199, which is an instant kill and will certainly result in a game over. And since the CPU still has Reflect, I just have Rosa heal every turn and slowly beat it to death. Can't use summons on Meteor because that will kill the attack node and leave the CPU alone. But once the CPU goes down, the attack node then goes down very quickly. Edge reaches level 47. With the CPU destroyed, we've stopped the Giant of Babil. Gobez barges in and he's pretty pissed we broke his new toy. But Fusoya approaches Gobez and tells him to look deep inside and realise who he really is. He casts a spell that knocks the both of them down. Suddenly, Gobez becomes aware and doesn't understand why he was filled with so much hatred. Now Gobez's true self has been restored, Fusoya asks if he knows his father's name, to which Gobez replies with, Kluya. This of course makes Gobez Cecil's brother, and it also answers another lingering thing Kluya mentioned back at Mount Ordeals. Kluya said that by giving Cecil the power of a paladin, his own pain would grow. That's because he was giving one of his sons the means to kill his other son, the one that, as we find in the DS remake, he actually knew and had a few years to raise himself. But it also explains why Gobez couldn't finish Cecil at the Tower of Zot. Just as Gobez's control over Cain was weakened by Tell's Meteor, so was Zemus's control over Gobez, letting his true self hold him back. Fusoya says that Gobez was Zemus's puppet in his plan to destroy Earth. He needed a Lunarian, and Gobez was the only feasible option on the planet at the time. Fusoya collapses during his explanation, so Rydia and Edge check on him, while Rosa keeps an eye on Cecil. Cecil is, understandably, very shaken that all the hatred he had built up was against his own family. It also makes him wonder why Gobez was chosen, and that it could have easily been him instead. Gobez says it was because of the possibility of evil that was inside him that Zemus saw and manipulated to make it grow. Gobez turns to leave, saying that he intends to settle things with Zemus. Fusoya decides to accompany him. He's fought Zemus before, so he at least knows what to expect. Gobez says goodbye and leaves, but Cecil can't face him. The party ask him if this is what he wants, but Cecil's not ready to accept things yet. That and the Giant of Babel begins to collapse. Even then, escape isn't on Cecil's mind. Then Cain shows up. With Zemus' control over Gobez gone, so is Gobez's control over Cain by extension. He leads the party out of the giant. The giant then crumbles in another new cutscene. Back in the Lunar Whale, Cain says he doesn't expect forgiveness, to which Edge wasn't going to give any to start with, saying the giant was his fault. But Rosa stands up for him, pointing out how powerful Zemus' control is, leading to Cain being filled in on what he missed. When told that Gobez and Fusoya went after Zemus, Cain also wants to follow them and have his own go at payback. Edge says he hopes Cain doesn't betray them again, to which Cain says we have permission to kill him if that happens. Please, don't give me that possibility and then never follow on with it. Edge wants to go too, and Cecil finally speaks up and says he'll be going as well. But first he tells Rydia and Rosa to stay behind, that he can't put them in that kind of danger. They try to argue back, but he just asks again, leading to a hurt Rosa walking out. It's clear it's a hard decision for Cecil. Meanwhile, Edge just walks up to Rydia and patronises her, so Rydia storms off out as well. Even after she walks out, he has to get the last word in. The remaining three take off and land on the moon. But as they go to get off, it turns out Rosa never left. Cecil tries to get her to let him out, but she isn't having it unless he takes her with him. She doesn't care about the danger, as long as she gets to be with him. Cecil gives in, and the two become that abomination again. Meanwhile, Rydia is just happy it worked, saying this is everyone's battle. Cecil is surprised at her being here too, but his mind has already been changed, so it's fine. After the party leave, a Hummingway tells me I can now change party members at Mysidia's Hall of Prayer. So before I continue, I have to talk about this bit, don't I? I'd say the previous scene is probably the most criticised part of the game story-wise. Cecil's decision to remove the women from the team is not just sexist, but also really stupid because he's removing their healer and a summoner from the team. And I don't disagree, it feels like a last minute bit of forced conflict before we enter the phase of the game where we have no story left outside the final boss segment. But at the same time, I do think Cecil's decision is in character and I can empathise, even if I disagree. He's coming from a good place, but didn't take into account the feelings of those he's making the decision for. There's the obvious fact that it's unlikely all five of them will survive and Cecil doesn't want his girlfriend dead. And with Rydia, he still likely has lingering guilt over killing a mother and burning her home down, so I can see him not wanting to feel responsible for her death on top of that. Personally, I've always kind of seen Cecil's mentality of going for Zemus as a suicide mission. Healing and summons won't matter because they're all dying anyway, and he doesn't want to drag Rosa and Rydia down with him. And then you could also say, but then why would he bring Edge and Cain if he's certain no one's going to survive? And you'd be right in asking that. But for me, personally, if I knew I was on a suicide mission and I knew I was not going to survive, I'd also want to drag Cain and Edge down with me. Like, if I'm going to get killed, they better fucking die too. But in the end, the game itself is on the side of the women. They use the little animation they have to show how hurt Rosa is by this. And they make already established Dick Edge be the biggest arsehole to show how his attitude towards this is different than Cecil's. Where Cecil is doing it out of good intentions, Edge is just a condescending arsehole. Rydia even ends the scene pointing out just how useful she is. I also feel like there's an attempt at misdirection going on. I feel they wanted us to think that maybe Rosa and Rydia were being removed in favour of Fusoya and Gorbez being the party's main mages for the final battle. I have one last question though. Where did Rosa and Rydia hide? Is there a low level that we don't see when we exit, or did Rosa hold on to Rydia and the outside of a lunar whale with her bare hands the entire way there? The latter isn't too unbelievable to me. Well, back to the game. While Kane was away, he reached level 50. We're heading straight back to Earth to test out that party changing. This was added to the GBA version and stuck around for this one. Every other version of the game, the final party is fixed at Cecil, Rosa, Kane, Rydia and Edge. But first I go back to the Sylph Cave, and watching this recording back, I couldn't remember why. It turns out there's a summon book on the bookshelf. I can't remember if this is here before, or only after the giant is dealt with and Yang has left. It summons a random Eidolon. But now that party swap in. In the Hall of Prayer, it's not just the other party members there, but Cid's workers, Jot and Luca, and two Epops. I just have to talk to one of the other five to get a party selection screen. First thing I do is replace Kane, Edge and Rydia with Cid, Yang and Edward. This allows the party combinations that were never seen in the original releases. Like here, Cid was never originally in the party at the same time as Edward. While they were away, Cid and Yang reached level 49 and Edward level 50. Change party once and a white mage barges in and walks to the Elder. She says Mount Ordeals is covered in a sinister cloud. He tells Cecil of an old Mycidian myth, a new path that opens on Mount Ordeals for those who have fulfilled their fate. First step is to load my free returnees with either their old equipment or better stuff I've obtained since. I see no such cloud, lying arsehole, but as I enter, lightning strikes at the northern end of the screen. When I walk there, there's a new door I can enter. It leads to the first room of the Cave of Trials. It looks identical to the room where Cecil became a paladin, but then a door opens in the back to the true Cave of Trials. This is a place also added for the GBA port to make these since surpassed party members and Yang more useful for the endgame. I go north up the stairs and to the first chest, and then east through the hidden passage to the second. Then I backtrack to just above those stairs and go west and north up two more sets to reach the next floor. The first chest contains an X potion, the second has a red jacket. This gives Edward a much needed defense boost. That's all, and it's down to floor B2. I start by going northwest to the first chest. At the eastern wall I go north up the stairs, west and down the stairs, west some more and taking the second set of stairs on the way. Then up the next set of stairs going south and keep going north to the second chest. Then all the way south and west and north to a hidden passage to the third chest. Then back down those stairs and south to the next floor. First chest is a remedy, second has a phoenix down, the third is a hypno crown. None of the party can equip it. Down to floor B3. I go south and through a hidden passage to the east that leads even further south, then west to the first chest. I backtrack and go south, west and north up some stairs to the second chest. Then it's northeast to a hidden passage to the third chest. Backtrack all the way west and south down some stairs towards the exit. First chest is a cat ear hood, once again no one here can equip it. Second is a remedy. Third is a white tiger mask which is for Yang. I should say I haven't been covering fights here because this place is almost entirely returning enemies. Down to B4. This has me go directly south for a chest, then east through a hidden passage for a second. I backtrack a bit and go north, southeast and north again to a third. Backtrack again and go up the stairs, east through a hidden passage to the fourth chest. Then backtrack to the stairs again and go north to the exit. First chest is a red cap for Edward, second is a cottage. Third chest has a siren and the final chest is a brave suit for Yang. Then it's on to B5. First I go all the way west for my first chest, then back to the entrance and north for the second. West up the stairs, north, up the stairs, west through a hidden passage to the third chest. Backtrack and go south and west through another hidden passage, then south some more to the third, exiting the northeast corner. First chest is a siren, second is a remedy. On the way to the third, Cecil reaches level 51 and Rosa level 50 in the same fight. Next fight sees Edward reach level 51. Third chest has a robe of lords that no one can equip. The last chest has a sage's robe that also can't be equipped right now. Next fight has Yang reach level 50. On to B6. All the way east, up the stairs, all the way west, north up the stairs, north and east through the hidden passage of two chests. Then back down the stairs and go east, down the stairs, east some more to the other side of the room, south to the third chest and north to the exit. The first chest has a grand helm for Cid. The second has a grand armour, also for Cid. The last chest is just a dry ether. On to B7. I'm not mapping this one. It's a straight line north to the next room, with a set of stairs to the east and west each that both lead to a chest. I actually get a new enemy on this floor, the Great Marlborough. Thankfully with these ones there's rarely, if ever, a situation where I'm stuck fighting more than two. A lot of fights with multiple enemies take longer than they normally would, as this party has no way to deal damage to multiple enemies outside of Yang's kick. Also, I believe I forgot to put the battle speed back up after the Odin fight at the end of last episode. Cid reaches level 50 from this fight. The first chest is a Megalixir, as is the second, then it's on to B8. In here are five weapons, one for each of the newly selectable party members. You can only try to grab the weapon if the party member it was designed for is in the current party. First, I tried to grab the hammer for Sid, but each weapon is also walled off by a boss fight. For this one, we have the Death Machine, a palette swap of an enemy from the final dungeon. It has 50,000 HP and no weaknesses. It has 4 attacks, of not very powerful flame and piercing laser. There's laser, which does damage based on its current HP, which usually means a lot, and the CPU's instant kill globe 199. All I can do for this fight is have Rosa heal and everyone else attack. While looking at this enemy, I also learned that mithril weapons do more damage to machine enemies. There's a lot of little quirks like that in this game that are easy to miss. This fight isn't bad, in fact, this is more bearable than the normal random encounter enemy this boss borrows its sprite from. Killing it gets me Thor's hammer. It has a massive attack boost, deals extra damage to machines on top of that, and casts Blitz when used as an item. The next weapon I try for is the Claw for Yarn, guarded by the Storm Dragon. This one has 40,000 HP and an ice weakness, shared by I don't have Rydia or Palom in the party. Like the Death Machine, it has only 4 moves: a physical attack, tornado, and maelstrom. Then there's Whirlwind, which deals high damage to the entire party. Of course, those last two moves are dangerous enough together that following one with the other is enough to ruin my day. Whirlwind is even enough to KO Edward at full HP thanks to his low HP growth, but given my 3 front row guys do around a combined 7,000 damage a turn, with Rosa's healing it only takes at most 8 turns to bring down. Killing it gets me the God Hand, Holy Element and huge boost to agility. Finally, I go for the Harp. This has me fight a Gigas Worm. It has 55,000 HP. This one automatically counters all physical attacks with one of its own. This one is the most simple of the 3 I face here, just beat and heal. And to make it faster, I berserk Seer and Cecil so they can beat it to death quicker. Killing it gets me Apollo's Harp, a huge attack boost for Edward, now he's not stuck dealing triple digits. It also deals extra damage to dragons and boosts spirit and agility. In the middle of the room is an exit next to the save point. I return to Mysidia and change up the entire party. Cecil cannot be removed, but everyone else is left behind in favour of bringing back Edge and Kane, and also Porom and Palom. This is another previously impossible combination. Neither Edge nor Kane ever shared a party with the twins originally. While they were stuck there, Edge went up to level 49 and the other 3 got to level 52. I also give them their new equipment I already found in the cave. Palom gets a Hypno Crown and Sage's Robe, while Porom gets a Katia Hood and Robe of Lords. While they were away, Porom learned Blink at level 23, Confuse at level 25, Shell at level 29, Dispel at level 31, Kuriga at level 33, Haste at level 38, Float at level 40, Reflect at level 44, Kuriga at level 48, and Holy at level 52. Meanwhile, Palom learned all black magic spells: Toad at level 22, Quake at level 23, Drain at level 26, Warp at level 29, Blizzager at level 32, Fireager at level 33, Thunderger at level 34, Brick at level 36, Osmos at level 40, Death at level 46, Tornado at level 48, Meteor at level 50, and Flare at level 52. So while I leave the footage of my heading back through the cave playing, I would like to talk about this edition a little bit. I love it. It was the only reason I bought this game on GBA back then. When I first heard of FF4 Advance, I wasn't too interested. I still had access to the SNES and PS1 versions, so I thought I wouldn't need it. Then I saw a screenshot in a magazine of Sid and Palom in the same party, and that got me interested. For one thing, just listen to that spell list the twins learned. That was all programmed in there from the beginning on the SNES, but unless you did ridiculous amounts of grinding, you'd never see any of it. So getting to put it all to use felt very good. It also actually gives a use to Porom's cry. It always had the effect of making enemies easy to steal from, but pre-GBA, she could never be in the party with Edge, so it was useless. But the best part is, it fixes the bullshit in the original of you spend hours with a total of 12 party members, grinding them up and getting them equipment, only for the game to yank them away. More than half of the characters you work on end up meaning nothing because they're taken away and you're forced into the same 5 characters at the end of the game. This addition just reduces the temporary characters to 2 gimmicky mages that aren't that great anyway. Like, I never liked Edge in this game. So having a character I both liked and found very useful like Yarn taken away after several dungeons with him in the party to make space for Edge is very frustrating. I've seen some say it doesn't make sense plot-wise because these people just came back from being seriously injured. Plus, if Cecil didn't want to take Rydia and Rosa to the final battle, why would he ever consider taking the 5-year-olds? None of that bothers me because it's always been clear that this is a non-canon extra. It's always been canon that the original final 5 were the ones that went to fight Zemus. Thing is, this edition kind of raised my standards a bit too high for the later GBA ports. Not so much for FF5, I knew that party swapping wouldn't make sense there, but definitely for FF6 Advance. I was so hoping we could use the ghost again, or a non-canon Bannon that doesn't cause a game over on death. And I don't buy the reason that all this has been left out of the DS and Pixel remaster, that it's for the sake of being true to the original. Because just by making it 3D slash changing the graphical style or remixing all the music, halving required XP for level ups and all that, it's no longer true to the original. I can forgive the DS version for leaving all this out. There's actual cutscenes now with voice acting, so making at least 3 new voiced cutscenes at the end of the game for every combination of 5 party members would be unfeasible. But the Pixel remaster had no excuse to not include content that had been a standard for 2D Final Fantasy IV since 2006. It's especially galling because the Pixel remaster uses GBA and PSP assets. I can lay off FF1 and 2's remasters with the authenticity reasoning because at least those games do play very differently pre and post GBA. But 4, 5 and 6 have no excuse. Skipping ahead to getting back to floor B7, Cecil and the twins both gained a level each. Here I use a siren to fight a golden toad. These are a pain. They cast Toad on the entire party, have huge defense, absorb all elements, cast Blink and Reflect on themselves, and can flee so it doesn't get added to my bestiary. It even absorbs Meteor. It can be stopped though, and Edge of Shurikens bypasses defenses. As for magic, only Flare can do decent damage to it, which finally kills it. Edge reaches level 50 from this, and the Toad drops a golden apple. I give it to Palom. Now for those last two weapons. First I try the dagger for Palom. This puts me in a fight with a Flan Master, backed up by 2 white moose and 2 black flans. It has 35,000 HP and starts by casting Reflect on itself. It will also replace the flans if I kill all 4 of them and then bounce strong spells off of itself. Edge's ninjutsu bypasses Reflect, so that's fine for him. Cecil and Kane just jump while I have Palom cast Quake and Porom heal. This one's not too bad. Killing it gets me Triton's dagger. It increases Palom's intelligence a lot and casts Flood when used as an item. Finally, I approach the staff for Porom to battle a Tyrannosaurus. It has 60,000 HP. Its main attack is Earthshaker, which is worthless because I cast Float on the entire party beforehand. Other than that, it has physicals and counters the 3 main elemental spells with whole party target invariants. Cecil and Edge attack, Kane jumps and Palom cast Flare for a nice 9,999 damage for half the price and double the speed of Meteor. This one doesn't last very long. Kane reaches level 53 from this fight. I obtain Seraphim's Mace. It casts a Suna when used as an item, does extra damage to the undead and gives Porom a huge attack boost. Now it's time to return to the canon party and go back to the moon. Rosa reached level 51 while she was gone and Rydia level 50, learning Break at level 49. I head off back to the Crystal Palace. One thing that's always been a pain at this point is that every time you want to leave and re-enter the final dungeon, you have to go through the 2 lunar tunnels there and back. On the way, Cecil reaches level 53. Rosa reaches level 52 from the next fight. I return to the Crystal Tower and go back into the second floor with the crystals. One says that the fall of the Tower of Babil broke the seal and allows me to go after Zemus, but the tower is still up. I don't know if it's a lost in translation thing, but the Tower of Babil and its rule have always been a little vague and confusing. Like, the giant fell, not the tower. But I know at least that the WiiWare version of the sequel words it as if the tower disappeared when once again, it never goes anywhere. But anyway, one crystal also tells me that powerful weapons that pose a threat to the Lunarians were also sealed in the core with Zemus. When I step on the tile in the middle, the crystals guide me to the core. This is the Lunar Subterrane, the final dungeon of this game. It's by far the biggest one too. There's a lot to cover. I start by going west through a hidden passage to a teleporter on the other side of the screen, then north to some stairs. All this happens without a fight. On to B2. I go north to a chest and around to another teleporter. From the teleporter I go south and west to some more stairs. The chest contains a monster in a box, 2 Dark Sages and 2 Moon Maidens. They drop a Sage's staff for Rosa. Onto B3. Here I go north to this sword. This is one of those powerful weapons the crystal told me about. I inspect it, but it's protected by a monster. This one is a white dragon. It has 32,700 HP and absorbs fire, ice and lightning. It counters all physical attacks with slow and all magic attacks with earthquake. This is why I cast float on the party before the fight. It's also another one that has maelstrom. At this point I can just spam attack, jump and the hammer with Rosa healing. It also has a regular non-counter physical attack to watch out for too. It isn't much of a problem by this point and I bring it down. Edge reaches level 51. I obtained the Murasame, a very powerful katana for Edge. That was one side path, now I'll backtrack to the first screen. When I get back, I go east through a hidden passage and follow it north, west and south to a chest. Then I return to the central section and go south to some stairs. The chest is a monster in a box. 2 armored fiends to kill gets me a black garb, the best armor for Edge pre-GBA. In the next fight, Rydia reaches level 51 and learns Tornado. In the fight after, Kane reaches level 54, so does Cecil in the fight after that one. A couple fights later, Rosa reaches level 53. Back down to B2. Here I go south and east into a hidden passage leading north. On the way, there's a bit west leading to a chest. At the north end, I go west, through another hidden passage, past the stairs to a second chest, then take the stairs. First chest is a flame whip for Rydia. This will be useful for some undead enemies in here that I don't want to waste her MP on. The second is a dragon shield for Kane. He rejoins the full set of Genji armour, but dragon armour is better. And back to B3. The stairs going down are directly south, but below it there's a hidden passage east to a chest. And from there another one going south to a second, and west of that chest there's a third. I then take those stairs. In my first fight on this floor, Edge reaches level 52. The first chest has Kane's dragon helm. The second has a dragon mail for him. The third has dragon gloves, and Kane's entire Genji set is now replaced with the dragon set, down to floor B4. I go all the way east, past the stairs to the first chest, then down those stairs and west to a room with a second, then all the way east and south, then west into a tunnel going west containing two more chests. As I exit back into this room, I grab the fifth chest a little south and take the stairs down to the next level. The first chest has Artemis arrows I immediately throw away for space. The second one inside the small room is an elixir. In the tunnel through the second door, the third chest has a white fang. In here I get a bone dragon variant, the dino zombie. The fourth chest has an X potion. At the end of my next fight, Kane reaches level 55 and Rydia reaches level 52 and learns death. The fifth chest back outside is a monster in a box. It's a behemoth. Cecil reaches level 55 and I gain a stardust rod. Next fight has Rosa reach level 54, down to B5. Here I just go south, west past the door for a chest, then in the door. My first fight on this floor gets me a power swap of the clockwork dragon, the blue dragon. At this point, all new enemies have over 10,000 HP. Killing these gets Edge to level 53. The chest is a monster in a box, a blue dragon and another new variant, the red dragon. From killing them, I get a crystal shield for Cecil, then it's through that door. I go north and east through a hidden passage to a chest, then east through another and south back onto B5 for another chest. Then I come back here and go north through that exit. The first chest is a protect ring, I give it to Rosa for a huge defense boost. The second chest is a monster in a box, another behemoth, the crystal mail for Cecil. Then it's continuing to the rest of B5. I go east for a chest and then west into another cave entrance. The chest is another monster in a box, two red dragons. This is actually a tough one. They manage to get a couple deaths with their whole party thermal ray. Kane reaches level 56, Rydia reaches level 53, and I get Cecil's crystal gloves. After this I get another new enemy, the Ahriman. They cast Doom on a party member, a countdown from 10 to that party member's death. But I can beat them to death before that first countdown finishes, then it's back outside. Here I go north, then south to a chest, then back north to the exit. The chest has a white robe for Rosa, the exit takes me back to B5. I go northwest for a chest, then east into this room for another, then south to the next floor down. The chest is a monster in a box, a dark sage and a dino zombie. Killing them gets Rosa to level 55 for Holy, her final spell. It also gets us a crystal helm, and Cecil's crystal set is now complete. The second chest is a red fang. This room also contains a very rare enemy, only found in here. I use a siren to call it. The Flam Princess. These rare enemies also have a very rare drop that I'll deal with in a couple episodes time. Right now, I just want to kill them for the bestiary. But they berserk my party and start beating me to death with physicals. Once the entire party is berserked, I'm fucked and they beat me to death. I was not expecting it to go that badly. I last saved after obtaining the Murasame when I went to heal, so everything else I have to repeat. Here is where I remember I can use auto battle to speed up regular fights. Since this is the first serious attempt at a playthrough on PSP, it never crossed my mind until now. So much time I could have saved. This time I just grab that red fang and leave. I'll get it once I've saved next. Down to B6 I go east for a chest, west for a second, and south down some stairs for a third. Then I go west across this invisible bridge and north and east to this hidden exit. It puts me on the stairs further down where I go south to a fourth chest, then west to a teleporter leading to those stairs on the left. Then I take those stairs north to another teleporter. The first chest is a Fuma Shuriken, the second is more Artemis arrows. Getting back here, everyone reached the same level except Rosa, who's a level lower than when I died. The third chest is a cottage. After crossing the invisible bridge, Rosa re-reaches level 55 and relearns Holy. Fourth chest is a golden apple, it goes to Rosa. The teleporter at the north of those stairs takes me back to B5. I go all the way north to another teleporter, grabbing a chest on the way. The teleporter puts me in a safe room with an exit that leads into the northeast corner of B5 where I can try to grab this sword. The chest is a monster in a box with a behemoth inside. Killing it gets me another protect ring I give to Rydia. Being able to finally save in here and know I won't lose everything a second time makes me pretty happy. I try grabbing that sword only to be stopped again. This time it's protected by Dark Bahamut. He has 60,000 HP and starts the fight with Mega Flare. He'll then cast Reflect on himself and bounce regular flare off himself to the party. He also counters summon damage with Mega Flare, so summoning the original Bahamut is out of the question. Cecil and Edge attack, Rosa heals, Kane jumps, and I have Rydia casting Quake, as it's the only spell she has that'll bypass Reflect and damage him. This fight seems terrifying thanks to the Mega Flare opening, but it isn't that bad really. You know he's close to death because he'll start healing himself for 6,000. Fittingly enough, Cecil gets the last blow in so that we can grab his pre-GBA ultimate weapon, Ragnarok. Another 42 attack over the Excalibur. This is a strong one. Now it's time to backtrack to B6. Back at the beginning of this room, I take Vison stairs down and around to the exit. In here, it's northwest to a chest and northeast to the exit. The chest is another monster in a box. A Dark Sage and three Moon Maidens. Killing them gets me a Minerva boostier for Rydia. A couple more fights later, Rydia reaches level 54, then it's down to B7. I go south where there's three doorways. First takes me to the final save point in the main game, second and third will get me treasures. Then it's all the way east and north, then west, down the stairs and west some more into the exit. The second room has a lance that puts me in another boss battle if I try to take it. The Plague Horror has 33,333 HP and starts by inflicting doom on the entire party. So I'm on a short clock, especially when it casts haste on the party. I just have to outdamage him, so I have Kane jump, Rydia summon Bahamut and Rosa Berserk Cecil on edge so they hit harder. After that I have a cast Holy. I manage to kill it with the timer down to 3. I now have Kane's Holy Lance, his strongest weapon in vanilla FF4. It replaces the gun near he joined holding. The third door has two chests that when I approach also trigger a boss fight. Here we have two Lunar Swords with 23,000 HP each and a weakness to fire. But they start by casting Reflect on themselves and bouncing spells at me. But Cecil's Ragnarok hits the damage cap on these, so they go down easily. Rosa reaches level 56. Both chests contain ribbons. These can be equipped by anyone to prevent all status effects. Wait, when did Cecil and Kane reach level 57? I give them to my mages because they stand to lose the most from being affected by the likes of Silence and Berserk. I haven't faced an enemy still and use a siren on this floor to fight a little murderer. These float and will scan themselves to tell you their lightning weakness, but if you actually use a lightning spell on them, they go apeshit on you. They'll never attack you if you don't, so you can just beat them to death. I check my bestiary to find I'm at 78%. Now for those flam princesses. Since Rosa and Rydia cannot be berserked now, I can keep the party alive and mega flare them to death. That's one more for the bestiary. And now to B8. We know we're nearly there because the giant theme starts playing and we have a new environment. I go east and down the stairs, then all the way west to a chest. Then down more stairs and east, taking a detour to this sword. After that I go around to the exit. My first fight is against the Death Mask. I hate these things. They start every fight reflecting themselves on the entire party, plus their ridiculous 37,000 HP for a random encounter. I always run from these assholes. I kill one for the bestiary and then run from the others, least favourite enemy in the game. One side note, another cool way the game shows how serious things are is that in these last few floors, all random encounters will now play the boss theme instead. That's really cool. The only chest on this floor is a Fuma Shuriken. I approach the final of these sealed weapons for the last boss fight before we reach Zemus, Ogopogo. This is a beat up Leviathan with 50,000 HP. It will always start the fight with two deluges before attacking for 3 turns and then throwing out another. It counters magic and summons with Frost Blast and lightning magic with Whirl. The beaters do their thing, Rosa heals and Rydia casts Quake. After dealing with everything else in here, this guy isn't much of a threat. This gets me the Masamune, another incredibly powerful weapon for Edge. On to B9. Here I go south and east for a chest, then south and west all the way. South some more and east to the next floor, grabbing a second chest on the way. The first chest is an elixir and the second is a guitar whistle. On to B10. Here I go west, south, east and down the stairs to a chest, then all the way west to a second chest. Then it's southeast to the next floor. There's that one spot in the southwest corner that looks made for a save point, but I've never seen one there. Maybe an easy type? First chest is a Fuma Shuriken, as is the second. Down to B11, the final floor before it all goes down. And it's the simplest one, no chests, just to the west, south, east, south and west to the exit. There's two enemies left to find on this floor. First we have Zemus's Malice. It has high defense and casts Protect on itself. It also has a shit ton of HP. These are so important that when they die, they get the boss death and break away. Cecil and Kane reach level 58 and Edge reaches level 56 from this one. The next one is Zemus's Breath. This one does nothing but scan the party, reporting its findings to Zemus, which also makes it easy to beat it to death. It also dies like a boss. Rydia reaches level 55 and learns Flare. I kill a couple more of these to get Rosa to level 57, then it's down to the next floor. Here we see that Fusoya and Golbez have already reached Zemus and take him on themselves. Fusoya tries status ailments on him while Golbez throws out the high level spells. Eventually they come to the conclusion that only Meteor will work, so they both pool together to cast Twin Meteor and finish him. Well, that was easy. Zemus says that his body dies, but his spirit lives on. Zemus is down and Fusoya compliments Golbez's strength. The party surround the two to celebrate their victory. Colvis says Cecil's name, but Cecil still can't look at him. But it's all cut short as Zemus's body starts twitching and transforms. His lingering hatred survived and was reborn as Zeromus. He starts by knocking out the party, leaving just Fusoya and Golbez. Golbez vows to end him completely. They both start by casting Meteor on Zeromus, but he actually absorbs it. Fusoya says to use a crystal on him, but it doesn't work. Golbez's soul is too tainted by Zemus's control for it to work. Zeromus uses his own Meteor and takes the two out. Zeromus threatens to expand his hatred until everything is destroyed, but back in the Hall of Prayer, the others can feel that Cecil's group are in trouble. So Vielda has everyone present pray for their safety. Everyone there, the twins, Young, Edward, Sid, his workers, the E-Pops, Jot and Luca all have their own things to say as Vielda prays to the twin moons to accept those prayers. Cecil wakes up and runs to help Golbez. Golbez gives him the crystal he tried to use, knowing that it will work for Cecil. Cecil simply tells Zeromus he can't lose and the final battle begins. But it's just Cecil alone at 1 HP. The prayers from Porom and Palom revive the others. Edward is next with help from Teller Spirit. Their prayers heal Rosa and Rydia. Sid and Young are next and their prayers heal Kane and Edge. Then comes Fusoya who heals Cecil, while Golbez tells him to use the crystal with his holy power and reveals Zeromus' true self. Using the crystal will reveal Zeromus as a giant brown bug. Zeromus has 65,498 HP. His signature move is Big Bang, which you are warned by when he shakes. It can deal around 2,000 damage and inflict sap on the party, so they keep losing health. He also has Black Hole, which removes any buffing spells. He also likes to cast a full party bio. I have Edge throw the Fuma Shurikens I picked up on the way here and attack after they run out. Cecil attacks, Kane jumps, Rosa heals and Rydia summons Bahamut. He counters Bahamut and powerful magic like Holy and Flare by casting Flare himself. Zeromus can be hard if you're unprepared, but in my experience the main sticking point for difficulty is your maximum HP. If your entire party can only barely survive a big bang, it's going to be a hard time. And all this while a quite good final boss theme plays. This is one of those strange ones where it's not one of my favourites to listen to outside of the game, but in the moment it really gets me pumped. When Zeromus's HP gets low, he will start casting Meteor and Flare without being a counter, but you can tell he's getting weak because his Meteor misses most of the party and deals very little damage compared to what it used to. And in the end... Zeromus threatens that he will never be truly extinguished as long as evil still exists within people before he fades away. Fusoya congratulates the party on their victory and states that maybe the people of Earth have already evolved past the Lunarians. Kane worries about Zeromus' last words. Fusoya says that true evil will never die as everyone has at least a little inside of them, as well as at least a little good, and it was the good that managed to defeat Zemus. Edge brags about how great he is, for Rydia to say she's surprised Zemus didn't control him. Fusoya says it's time for him to return home. The party will do the same, there's many people left behind worrying about them. Fusoya is glad to see his nephew has such good friends. Golbez then asks to come with him. He feels he cannot return to Earth after what he did and would like to meet his father's people. Fusoya accepts his request, warning that he's in for a long sleep. Before he leaves, Golbez tells Cecil that he sounded worried when he called Golbez's name, but believes it would be impossible for Cecil to truly forgive him after what he's caused. The two then go off to sleep, as viewers ask Cecil if this is how he wants to end things, as they are unlikely to see each other again. After Golbez gives his final farewell, Cecil finally does the same, even calling him his brother. Golbez simply thanks him and goes with Fusoya to sleep. The screen fades out and we see the solar system, with the Earth and its two moons rotating by while the Mycidian legend scrolls by. But the legend then continues, saying the moon will travel again, seeking another planet, keeping the brothers apart. The Lunar Whale is returned to the ocean by Mycidia and we get to see how everyone's lives went after things calmed down. Porom is ready for the day's training, but Palom is late. Porom finds him flirting with another unexpected future party member about his amazing adventures and gets a smack and dragged off back. The Elder tells him if he keeps slacking, he will never be a sage like Teller as he wants to be and doubles his training for the day. The Seneschal nags Edge about finally becoming a responsible adult now that he's going to be King of Eblan. Edge blows off his concerns and leaves, revealing he's actually fallen for Rydia. I don't fancy your chances. Rydia is in the Fae March where everyone still loves her. She even comforts a monster who wants to look more human like her with the old, we're all living creatures and it's what's inside that counts, the usual. Because Yang is now the undisputed best in the world at punching, the King of Fabul has vacated the throne to him. Yang tries to get Sheila to talk more formal now that she's a queen, but she's not putting up with that bullshit. Yang then leaves with the other monks to go training, while now Duke Consort thinks Yang will make Fabul even greater. Edward, now king and with help from the Epops, is busy rebuilding Damsian Castle. Some kids ask him to play his new paladin song, but he tells them only after their work for the day is done. He ends this scene hoping Anna is watching over him and that her and Teller are happy together. The dwarves are also rebuilding their own castle. Jot is so sure that war is forever over that he tells them to scrap the tanks and materials. Luca wonders how Cecil and the others are doing. Jot tells her that Cecil and Rosa are now the new king and queen of Baron, and that they're invited to the coronation slash wedding. Guess it's cheaper to do both at once. One person who won't be going is Kane, who can't bring himself to face them yet. Instead, he's going to train at Mount Ordeals for the next 17 years so he can hijack the game's sequel from what should have been its main character. Once he accomplishes that, he'll return to Baron. Meanwhile, Corio, remember him, is told to look at the moon through the telescope. The Lunarian's moon leaves the orbit of the Earth to seek out another planet. We then see Cecil and Rosa in their room. Cecil believes he heard Gorbez's voice, but brushes it off as his imagination. Sid comes in to push him to get ready for their big day. Rosa tells Sid not to suddenly become formal with them, and Sid is fine with that. Rosa then leaves with him to get ready. When she leaves, Cecil says it wasn't his imagination. He heard Gorbez say farewell. In the throne room, everyone visits one by one. Edge is first and checks out Rosa, so Sid drags him away and makes him stay put. Next are Jot and Luca. After Jot speaks to all the royalty, he doesn't notice that Luca's developed a little crush on Cecil and just stares at him, so he drags her to his side. Yang's always been disciplined and polite, so he's just in there with a greeting and stands next to Sid. Palom's a little shit and jumps on the throne, so Porom smacks him and drags him away before the Elder shows up. He has to be dragged away again when he tries hitting on Luca. Edward is like Yang, to the point. Finally, there's Rydia. She even tries to talk to Edge, but Edge is too embarrassed to look at her. Everyone takes their places and then waves at the camera before the credits start. These are really long. The credits theme loops so many times to accommodate all the extra credits for the PSP version. Once they're done, back on the moon next to this face, a new dungeon opens. The Lunar Ruins is open and I've unlocked trials for the 5 characters I defeated Zeromus with. So I save and start up my clear save. And I defeat Zeromus with Yang, Sid and Edward in my party to unlock their trials. During the quest back through the Lunar Subterrane, Cecil and Edward reach level 59, Yang and Rosa level 58, and Sid level 57. And I do it again with Porom and Palom to unlock their shared trial. It turns out I didn't need to do this a third time, I thought you had to defeat Zeromus with both, but only one would have done. From this one, the twins reach level 61, with Porom having learned Arise at level 54, Cecil level 60, Yang level 59, and Sid level 58. I may have been the game, but I am far from done. I still have 5 more parts planned to this game. Part 5 will cover obtaining the rare summons, Part 6 and 7 will cover the tedious journey to maxing HP and MP respectively, and I'll use that chance to give my overall feelings on each character. Part 8 will have me play Final Fantasy IV Interlude for the first time, but next, Part 4 will be entirely devoted to the extra dungeon, the Lunar Ruins.